Hi, I'm Dr. Tony Nettleman. I just recently passed my California PLS exam last year, and I created this video to share with you my top tips and tricks to pass your California PLS on the first try. Now, when you look at the California PLS rubric or the blueprint, it's unbelievable. You know, it's got these five or six categories of questions, but within each of those five or six categories, there are 10 or 20 or 50 different skills you have to have. And that just, I mean, it blows my mind because there's only a 70 question exam and they're going to cover everything, surveying from construction to boundary to legal descriptions to coordinates. It's unbelievable. So I quickly learned after looking at this thing that this blueprint is totally worthless. I mean, it's everything from a, you know, certificate up to a PhD level college material on surveying. And it, personally, I don't think any surveyor could learn everything about surveying. I certainly learn every day. So it's really interesting, but basically this is not going to help you very much. Now, after I took the exam, I began to realize there's these things you have to have in your toolkit, these, you know, essential skills. And just thinking back on my own personal experience, I think of three things you've got to have as essential skills. Number one, you've got to be a really solid boundary surveyor. I love the California exam because California is all about boundary surveying. How to write legal descriptions, how to interpret legal descriptions, simultaneous conveyances, sequential conveyances. Number two, construction and COGO. COGO, otherwise known as coordinate geometry, consists of stubbing and inversing. And then you've got your construction surveying, which is like horizontal curves, vertical curves, area calculations using coordinates or bearing distance, all these things. And it's so weird because I've had students of mine tell me they haven't gotten a single curve sometimes. But I've had my own experience where I had a ton of curves. So I have no idea how these exam questions get generated, but based on my experience, knowing the curves is important. And then third, the acts, the rules, and the Subdivision Map Act. There's a lot of statutes you have to know as a California surveyor, but the three most heavily tested statutes are the acts, the rules, and the Subdivision Map Act. So let's go through each one of these step by step and let's talk about them. Now, number one is having a solid foundation as a boundary surveyor. And what I mean by that is junior senior rights in sequential conveyances, knowing not to proportion outside the block or the subdivision, and knowing not to proportion streets inside, you know, simultaneous conveyances. Being able to follow the record, you know, what does the deed say, and not going beyond the written record. And finally, just being able to read a legal description and understand it. So basically, everything that has to do with boundary surveying is often tested. And it's tough. I mean, they give you answer choices that look really similar, and it takes a lot of guesswork and crossing your fingers to pick the best answer. Probably the most common kind of boundary question is going to be, you know, given a series of sequential conveyances, who owns what? So you use your first in time, first in right mindset, and you put down the guy who bought in 1900, then you put down the guy who bought in 1930, then you put down the guy in 1970, and finally the guy in 2000. What's left over? Those are pretty common questions. Second, construction and COGO. And let's do each of these separately. So first of all, coordinate geometry. There are two kinds of COGO. You've got your stubbing, and then you have inversing. To stub is to begin at point A, go out a certain bearing and distance, and find the coordinates for point B. That's a stub. On the other hand, you've got inversing. Coordinates of point A, coordinates of point B. You compute the bearing and distance between the two points. But California doesn't stop there. They like giving you like as-built coordinates versus design coordinates. And then they make you inverse or stub several places, you know, do an entire, you know, series of inverses or stubs and see if you're smart enough to use the actual coordinates and not the design, because the design coordinates are just fantasy. And obviously construction, vertical curves, horizontal curves. They also like doing slope staking. I hate slope staking. If I see a question like that, I'll skip it, but definitely be prepared to do horizontal and vertical curve parameter calculations, like what's the PI elevation? What's the tangent? What's the long chord? Your HP35 will do all of this for you. My number one tip is to bring an HP35 pre-programmed, because it will save you a lot of effort. And finally, third, your statutes. You have got to have a big statutes binder, which has the California Surveying Acts, the California Surveying Rules, the Subdivision Map Act, the Adverse Possession, Business Code, all of that good stuff. Make sure you have your statutes with you. Make sure they are annotated. Make sure they have a table of contents. Make sure they have tabs to find the most common statutes, because a big portion of this exam is statutes. And a lot of people just think of, you know, what does it take to become a surveyor? How much do I pay per year to keep my license? Are CEUs required? But really, in my own experience, there were a lot of questions about conflicts of interest. There were a lot of questions about confidentiality. And there were also just a ton of questions about these things called records of survey and corner records. Now, I come from a state like in Texas where we don't have any of this stuff. You know, there's no such thing as a corner record in Texas. But in California, there's a corner record for the actual monumented corner, and then there's a record of survey for the parcels. So make sure you know the difference between an ROS and a CR. That's really the acts and rules. Now, the other thing which really shocks people, this is kind of the yin to the yang, is the Subdivision Map Act. California loves building subdivisions. California government hates building subdivisions. So the Subdivision Map Act is a giant set of laws that tell us how you build a subdivision, how you design it, how it's approved, and all this stuff. And if I had to pick one of the most heavily tested topics on this exam, it's the Subdivision Map Act. So I expect you to be able to tell me, can I create my parcel via deed? Do I have to use a parcel map? Or is a tentative and final map required? So based on the size of the subdivision, the number of lots, the location, all that, what do I have to do in order to build my subdivision? If you can answer that simple question, then you will have this exam licked. All right, well, you are locked and loaded. You have the knowledge you need to pass this exam. Now it's up to you to go out and gather the books, the statutes, the courses, the calculators, everything you need, because this is a tough exam. it's got a 20% pass rate. That means 80 out of every 100 people will not pass this exam. That means you have to prepare yourself better than everybody else. You've got to be a killer. You've got to go in there and just murder this exam. Otherwise, it's going to turn the tide and it's going to murder you. So make sure you prepare yourself. Make sure you're mentally, emotionally, physically prepared for this thing, because in my opinion, this is the toughest exam in the country for surveyors. Take that as a challenge. Have fun. Learn some new stuff. And let me know when you pass your California exam, because I love success stories.